Hey guys, welcome back. This is Jess. Welcome to Hot Takes and Deep Dives. And I am actually completely psyched to be here with Jackie Warner. I mean, everyone knows you from multiple shows on Bravo, Workout, Thintervention. How you doing?
It's like, hi.
Hi.
I'm glad to be with you. Yeah, it's like crazy. Workout, it has such a hardcore like following. It's ridiculous. Like people that worked, I still get talked to every single day about Workout, which trust me, I'm ready to leave that show behind.
I mean, you mean like clients who like you're training, they're just like pumping you for?
No, not so much clients. It's really interesting. The people that are serious and know how serious minded I am and that I've been training for 25 years with great results, they read my books. So they've read all my books. They've done my DVDs for years. Some of them haven't even watched Workout. But the people that approach me on the street or at a restaurant or whatever, those or an elevator, those are the Workout fans.
That's amazing. And yeah. What is the most common theme or like question that you get from people like on the street?
Oh, I was so happy when you broke up with Mimi.
It's so funny because it's like a relationship from like a decade ago.
Yeah, I know. And oh, by the way, here's what's so funny. She's Brazilian and she moved back to São Paulo and we FaceTime every single week and we travel to see each other once a year. And we're like sisters, like seriously like sisters. She's my closest friend that I have. We just were not good, you know, romantically, yeah. But you know, she's smart. She learned English in a year and she speaks better English than most Americans, I'll be honest. Mm-hmm. And she's great with history. She's into history. She's into politics. She's got literary skills. So those are all the things, those intellectual qualities that I love in a friend.
Absolutely. And it is very common for women who date to, I mean, like if you ask any gay chick out there who are their three best friends, it's their exes.
Yeah. Women can do that, but men and women cannot. Men and women, once they separate, it's very hard for them to remain like close to each other.
So I guess like let's go back. I mean, I know that you're originally from Ohio and then you had this huge success in LA. I guess like let's go through it. What initially brought you from Ohio to LA?
Oh my gosh, because I grew up in Fairborn, Ohio, which is about, I'd say, 10 minutes from where I have my home now in Beaver Creek. And I grew up in Fairborn, and I was always the girl that just daydreamed my life away. I read all the fashion magazines, even though you had to like order them, especially. I ordered all the European, and we're talking about like in the 70s and 80s, mm-hmm. when things like that weren't accessible to us at all. We didn't have the internet. And I just always painted. I was very creative. I was always really into really kind of alternative music and punk, super into punk at that time.
Who did you grow up loving?
Like Violet Femmes and stuff like that. Susie and the Banshee. Susie and the Banshees, a lot of people don't consider her punk, but she was very avant-garde and she was really kind of punk for that time. Mm-hmm. Like Patti Smith. I love Patti Smith. So I was in the popular group, but I was the outsider of the popular group because I really was a loner within that popular group. So I'd grown up with all the kids. Like we knew each other since we were like 5 years old. You know, and that's how it is in a small town. But they did not know me at all. And I didn't give a shit about them. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? I did not care. My only goal was to grow up and drive out of Fairborn, Ohio as fast as I could. And that's what I did. I got accepted to a fashion school in Los Angeles. And I'd gotten a car at 17 years old. And I drove to L.A. from Ohio, which is like a 3-day trip, and I did it on no dose. All I did is just take like, you know, over the counter speed, and I didn't even
maniac.
I know. Well, I've always been like, I've got a good angel and a bad devil, you know. I'm always sort of on the wild side, but and I just drove across town, and I gotta tell you, it was the most a passionate and wonderful feeling I've ever felt of freedom. Every mile I got closer to LA was a mile away from, remember, Fairborn is, Ohio is a very evangelical, super Christian town. And I didn't believe in any of those moral messages at all.
Mm-hmm.
You know?
How old were you when you first realized you were gay? And like, how old were you when you like came out to your first person?
So I realized I was gay. I had my first relationship with a boy and I had my first relationship with a girl when I was 13. So I had a boyfriend at 13 for the first time, you know, like making out in the hallway kind of thing. And then I had a more serious, a sexual relationship with a cheerleader, you know, who was my best friend when I was 13. And I loved her. She was my first big crush. The boy, I couldn't understand what all my girlfriends were talking about when they were following these boys. And I wish he liked me. And when they kissed boys, they felt fireworks. Because when I would kiss my boyfriend, I felt nothing. Like zero. But when I would kiss my girlfriend, I felt fireworks. Like everything came alive in me. But I wasn't sure until I was 14. So at 14, I had another relationship with another cheerleader. I like cheerleaders. And then I knew, and I prayed on my knees every night for a year. Please, God, please don't make me gay. Please take this from me. Crying, praying, begging. I didn't want this burden. It wasn't acceptable in my strict Mormon household. And I was afraid. I was scared to death that I was going to be sent away to a camp if my parents found out about, which they would have. They would have sent me to a camp. And so there was a lot of fear around it. And so then I really suppressed all dating and sexual urges through high school. And that's where my loner came out. What, was I going to date a girl when there were no other gay girls in my school? No, I can't take a girl to the prom. And boys, once they date you for 3 months, they expect sex. They want to have sex with you, especially in high school. And I wasn't comfortable with that. So I really was quite alone until I came to beautiful, sunny Los Angeles, where I was out at the bars with my fake ID every single night, having sex every single night.
Where were you? So in LA, like, where were you going out? Like, were you just going to West Hollywood and like the bars around there?
Exactly. I was going out where everybody that was gay was going out. And back at that time, now it's more Silver Lake. Like, more women go to Silver Lake and live in Silver Lake. But back at that time, it was all about West Hollywood. And I remember this club, and it was called Peanuts. Mm-hmm. And it was around for like forever. And that was the one club that had like a lesbian night. And the girls were beautiful. You know, it was like it attracted all kinds of people. Yeah. And it attracted a lot of straight people, too. And I also, you know, Jillian Michaels from Biggest Loser. Well, we were together. We dated 6.5 years, lived together. And during part of that time, we promoted nightclubs, very successful nightclubs. They were mixed. Like, we had Leonardo DiCaprio come to our nightclubs. We had Jenny McCarthy. We had Grace Jones.
Oh, my God.
She was a regular, plus a lot of lesbians of every kind, like feminine lesbians, butch lesbians, all that. So I was really familiar with the nightclub scene. And by the way, it is a brutal, the women that were doing clubs in opposition to us, I mean, they will cut a bitch.
Uh-huh.
I got in fist fights.
Well, I know that, are you familiar with like Dinah Shore out in Palm Springs? So I know that like there used to be this rivalry between the two club promoters, like Club Skirts and like this other club promoter that they
Mariah was the girl that did Dinah Shore, and she's one of those. She will cut a bitch. I mean, she is really tough, and she pretty much drove the other promotion out of town through real ugly behavior. I'm not a super big fan.
They later like fictionalized that rivalry among the women who run these gay clubs on the L Word. Like, I think in like the fifth season, I remember like Elizabeth Keener, who's Catherine Keener's sister, played.
Who I dated for 3 months.
Shut up. When? That's amazing.
Isn't that hilarious? We dated for 3 months, but she just wasn't my cup of tea. But, you know, the thing is no, the Catherine Keener was not about club skirts. That was about two monster promoters. They called them the mayor of West Hollywood. And their names were, I forget. It's going to come to me because it was just on the tip of my tongue. Anyway, these two women, they were a couple, but they would occasionally do three ways with another.
This is literally the fictionalized version. It's like literally the plot of The L Word.
They did it because it was so famous. Me and Jillian used to sneak in their club and flyer their clubs, and they would run us out of their clubs with bodyguards. Like doing that. Here's what they did. They paid off the fire marshals to shut us down on our first night over and over again because they paid them cash under the table. They paid the liquor boards under the table. We tried to do everything legitimate, but they were playing so ugly because they were so threatened by me and Jill, as they should have been, because we were young and we were the new blood and they were like already in their 40s and they were the old blood. They owned a bar called Girl Bar that was really, that was really big.
How did you meet Jillian Michaels initially?
I met Jill at a lesbian bar. She was 21. I was like 30. I think I'm like 9 years older than her. And I had just got carjacked that night. And on the way to a date, and someone at gunpoint took my car and my purse and everything. And so I was super bummed out. So who do you call? You call your best friend. So my best friends come pick me up and they say, you know what? They had a bottle of tequila and they said, tequila will solve this feeling. So we went from bar to bar and we ended up at this dive bar, Palms. And it was on Valentine's night. Nobody was out on Valentine's night because they were all booed up. And Jillian was sitting across the bar and I said, God, there's no good looking girls here. And my friend said, well, she's pretty cute. So I saunter over there, say something, try to order a drink. And she told me that when she got in the car and left that night, we exchanged numbers, that she had envisioned me and had several dreams of exactly what I look like. And she knew that we were going to be quite the item. And we were. I mean, that's the longest relationship that I had. I got her into training. I hired her at my first gym that I owned. My second gym we owned together. I turned down the biggest loser and put her up for it. I mean, you know, I was the older one.
You were offered the biggest loser?
Yeah. But I couldn't because I just opened my million-dollar beautiful gym that was on workout. I had put all my money into that gym. And I knew if I was going to be full-time working a TV show, I would lose all my capital and it would all go to waste. Because I was more the management. Jill was the training, was like the big mouth, and I was the management behind the scenes. And without me, I knew we would fail in 2 weeks. And look, I owned a penthouse glass enclosed gym in prime Beverly Hills. We're talking thousands of dollars in rent per month. We're not talking about like $3,000. We're talking about $15,000. And so there's no way I could have done that. So I just said, Jill, go to this audition. And you know what? I'll be honest. I've thought about this. She was the more fiery and the more emotional person between us two. And that's what that show required. She was the perfect person for that show. And then 2 weeks later, workout came and they offered me the show to shoot my own gym.
One more thing about Jillian. I mean, I've been a fan of both of you guys forever, but I remember particularly like the first chunk of time that Jillian was on The Biggest Loser, there was a lot of criticism in the gay community. Like I used to write for this lesbian website called Autostraddle. And I remember at the time we were heavily criticizing her because her big like quote unquote coming out was I think with like Red Book magazine. And she said she was bisexual when like we all knew she was gay. What was your experience of all of that? Like while she was closeted on The Biggest Loser, and actively hid it.
She was so scared. And I don't blame her. And if I had done, if I honestly, I think one of the big mistakes I made is to not say I was bisexual. When you say you're bisexual, then NBC, ABC, CBS will say, that's okay. She likes women, but primarily we know she likes men. I lost so many opportunities to people that didn't even have near my experience or name recognition just because I was gay. I had the head of marketing at Sears say, we love you. We wish we could do an all over store branding with you, but the gay thing, we just can't do it, which I could have sued that fucker. I could have sued him because he said it right in front of my agent after our third dinner together that they just can't work with me because the national public doesn't, you know, won't like that I'm an out gay person. So, you know, it has held me back from being on the cover of Self and Shape. I know 100% they wouldn't put me on their covers, even though I was on the covers of more legitimate magazines. You know, I was getting $300,000 deals when people that were not even well known were getting $1 million deals. And I know that being and saying I was a gay person, an out gay person, hurt my finances and it hurt a lot of my chances and opportunities. And that's a hard, cold truth that no one wants to talk about. Plus, it's different now. Remember, I was only about the second girl that was out. It was Ellen and it was me. And it was early times and people were not accepting. It's basically I've turned off more than half of America because I'm out, because that's what it is, because men just don't want it.
Why did you guys break up?
She's a lot to handle. She is, I used to call her Tasmanian devil. She got herself worked up into what you see on Biggest Loser, take that times 10, and that's her personal life. She always behaves in that same way. She's got a lot of anger issues. She's very, very aggressive. I can tell you hilarious stories to back that up, but I won't, just for her sake. But she's got major anger issues and major, you know, everybody's out to get her. She's one of those kind of persons that it's black or white. You're either all good or you are evil to the core. And most people avoid people that they consider evil to the core. She doesn't. She goes after you and she tries to destroy you. And I've seen it with her friends. I've seen it. She got married to help her best friend get his green card. And then she destroyed him. And he had to fight for 9 to 10 years after they got married to stay in the country. And even though she and I were just friends at that point, I'd say, what you're doing is wrong, Jillian. You're hurting somebody's life. Stop doing this.
Why did she marry somebody? She was trying to help her friend get a green card. I mean, what was in it for her? Like, she was just doing it to help her friend?
She was just doing it. He was her best friend and he was gay.
Okay.
And so they lived together for a short time. His name's David Ross. And he actually made a movie that did pretty well about the entire situation. Jill, he started getting really close to a boyfriend and cutting her out more and more, as we do when we fall in love. Our best friends, unfortunately, go along the wayside sometimes. It made her so envious and angry that she started targeting him aggressively and divorced him like 3 weeks after they got married, just so he would be thrown out of the country because she was punishing him. And I've got story after story of her doing that to people in her work environment and in her personal life. And it's just not, I don't operate that way. You know, I don't try to actively hurt people just because I don't like them.
When was the last time you saw her?
Like 4 years ago, but it wasn't a good time. I mean, she screamed at me that I was a monster and then wanted me to ride in her Lamborghini and I didn't want to. I mean, she's just all over the place. When she picked me up, they wouldn't let me leave my car at Pache, for instance. I'll give you an example. And I said, guys, come on. It was the valet. It was the Mexican valets. I said, guys, please let me pick up. Just leave my car. I drove a BMW at that time. At Pache, because we were going to go down the street and have dinner somewhere else. And we both lived in the same neighborhood. And she starts screaming at the guy at the top of her lungs, wads up a $20 bill in her hand and throws it in his face. That's Jill. Now, is that normal behavior to you? So the mean parts that you saw, that's her whole personality. but she's just manipulative enough to also, on camera at least, show you sweetness and consideration.
Yeah. Yeah, I watched her reality show, the one she did with her partner at the time and like her kids, whatever.
Yeah. Well, it was just gratuitous wealth. It was just constantly talking about how rich she was, and she constantly complained because I watched that show. I was curious myself. And every time she would sit down for an interview, all she would do is say, I'm, you know, it's too much. I'm pulled too thin, and Heidi wants this and the kids. And then I gotta do this, you know, thing and this show and that show. Look, when you're that filthy rich as she has become, you keep your mouth shut and you just pretend that you are thankful for everything. Like the Kardashians. The Kardashians are super smart. They're pulled every which way. They're filthy rich. Every time they get on camera, they say, blessings. They say, oh, it's all good, and I can't wait to show up to this photo shoot, and we got to go to New York, and it's going to be fun to Paris. Now, they're miserable. I'm certain they're miserable with their schedule, but they would never let you see it because the average person's working as an accountant or at Walmart does not want to see a very wealthy person with two homes and a G-Wagon and a family, a wife that she supports. Complain. And I think that's why that show got canceled. I think it's because she wasn't very likable on it.
So you drive out to LA, and how did you, like, what was your first, I know that you worked at Warner Brothers for a time. Like, what were you, like, after you graduated school?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, like, so take me through, like, what brought you to eventually get into fitness?
Well, it was interesting. I got in late in the game. So the deal was I went to fashion school. And I thought I wanted to do that because I thought it was just glamorous. But then I realized it's the most shallow, ridiculous thing to do with your life. I mean, who really cares about designing clothes? I mean, could you be more shallow? And I have that judgment even now. And if you look at the people that are big, you know, in the industry, they're just very shallow people. You know, they're very, and I'm not. I'm a deep thinker. I'm a sensitive person, and I knew I was too sensitive for that shallow industry. So I never worked in that industry. I worked odd jobs, and I decided to start a cellular company when cellular was just getting off the ground. And so I worked as a salesperson, and we worked for this total jerk, this guy. He was total misogynist. He was always hitting on us. I was only about 20 at the time. So me and the other top earner took a lunch together and said, let's steal all his clients and move into a crappy place and get a couple phones. We couldn't even afford phones. We rented phones. Mm-hmm. Call companies, pretend that we're a big business, and we'll go and go to the corporations like Fox or CBS and dress up and pretend that we're this big storefront corporation. Well, it worked. And within 3 months, I had 60 employees, an indoor and outdoor sales force, and was rich. And that was by the age of 21.
Wow. By 21, you did all that.
Yeah.
So you knew that you could, that you had a mind for business and that you could sell.
I knew I could sell. And if you can sell on this planet, you can do anything. I knew nothing about business. I had common sense, but I knew never took a business class. I didn't know how to write a business plan. I didn't know how to market myself, but I was a great salesperson. And once you have that, you've got major advantage. And you have to be an A-type personality. You know, it's very difficult to be somebody who's shy and become rich, you know?
What do you think is the biggest skill set that somebody in sales needs to cultivate in order to be hugely successful? Like if you could distill it down.
If I could distill it down, I read a lot of books. I'll give you an example. I couldn't afford an architect on one of my first buildings that I leased for business. I couldn't afford all that because it was very expensive. So I went to Barnes & Noble's and I got a book on how to do architectural design. And I got trades paper and, you know, the right material, and I learned how to do it. I learned how to draw it on it's like little cubes. If I don't know if you've seen architectural design, but each cube means like a certain space, like a foot. And so I learned how to draw all my own plans from that book. I didn't have someone go to Beverly Hills where they approve or don't approve your architectural plans. I drove it there on almost Christmas Eve, like right before they closed, and then got on a plane and came to Ohio, and they were approved. So I learned by reading. I have like 2-year degree in college. That's it. Everything else is because I've said, I wonder how to do a great business plan where I can get $100,000 in a week from people.
Right.
And then I sat down and I wrote the basics of it. And then I'm also a good storyteller, as you can probably tell.
Yeah, I love it.
And so I would embellish that story. And I'm really able with my training too, to take my passion and make it your passion. And that's what a good salesperson does. You know, for instance, I had a new client today right before this interview, and she's morbidly obese. And I had her at the end of that call thinking, man, I am going to be a hot athlete. I'm going to sleep well. I'm going to have more sex. I'm going to dress in all the clothes. I had her believing that dream, because you have to believe it to achieve it. You must. And I'm a great person at transferring my passion for something to another person. And that's part of salesmanship. That's what good salespeople do. Hey, I've bought many bad things from great salespeople, you know?
Yeah.
I've bought some really crappy, not working things because that salesperson had me.
Yeah, because you have to be really charming. And somebody who's charming can kind of like sell you on anything.
That's true, but charming and A-type personalities is learned. I was painfully shy when I was younger, painfully shy, and I knew I couldn't succeed in California. So I shaved my head because I used to be so self-conscious. I used to be thinking people are watching me, everyone's looking at me, but it was always negative. Like I must look like a hick, or I'm not dressed right. Like when I was 17, 18, 19, you know, insecure. So I said, here's what I'm going to do. I'm going to shave my head like Sinead O'Connor, and I'm going to walk around like that so everybody does look at me, and I'm going to know why they're looking at me, and I'm going to just know. And I swear to you, I did that for like 6 months, and it changed my whole personality. That's what I do. Yeah, that's what I do. When I see a fault in myself or a perceived weakness or fault, I go after it. I go after that until I kill that fault. But it's learned. I could teach this to anybody. As a matter of fact, through training, I've chosen to work with the body, but think of how much psychology we do. I have gotten people through the worst parts of their lives. I've gotten people in places that are the darkest, saddest, angriest places, hurt places, to somebody who is on top of the world and succeeding in every way of their life. I've always said a trainer is the most important job. If you are a good trainer, let's not say good, if you're a passionate, great trainer, it's more important than your doctor. It's more important than anybody else in your life, because I've seen great trainers transform people where they had nothing, and then they start just flourishing financially, mm-hmm. emotionally.
So you made all this money with the cellular company, and then did you just sink that in to Sky Sport and Spa, like the gym
I lost all the money.
Oh, so, what happened?
So it's hilarious. I'm not good with money. I've made a million and lost a million now 4 times over. But that's why I love California, because you can do that. You can lose everything. And then if you get some good ideas and just sit and focus and sit quiet for 2 hours and write some stuff down and then go for it, you can make it back again in a year. When 2008 happened, and the reason I lost all my money by 25 is because I was taking limos to the grocery store.
Why were you doing that?
Just because I could, and I thought it was fun. And I also made terrible investments of people that sold me on ideas that were bad ideas. And soon enough, a million just goes bye-bye. And then I got into the entertainment industry when I was 25 years old. And the first person I worked for was the Susan Powder Show. Do you know that?
Oh,
that
stop the Stop Powder? The Insanity woman.
Yeah. She was the first person I worked for. And she was crazy. I mean, she was just crazy.
And what did you do for her?
I was the audience coordinator for her, and I did PR.
Okay. And then how did you, were you inspired to get into fitness from her?
No, I had no inspiration to get into fitness. When I was 30, I went back to school to get my art degree because I'm a painter. You can see, like,
oh, yeah.
Yeah, I paint all kinds of stuff. And and everybody in my family, like, we're required to play at least 3 instruments, paint. It's a very creative family. And my mom's got her master's in photography. She's super well respected. So we have to be creative. It's just part of our DNA. So I went back to art school, and at 30, I started taking a couple clients that said, gosh, your body's in really great shape. Will you show me? Oh my gosh. I remember my first 3 clients. I didn't even have my degree yet in training. And we made such huge monumental changes, life changes together, that I was hooked like a drug. Because let me tell you, getting someone a 6-pack is not inspirational. Getting someone to quit their job, leave an abusive partner, get a better job, find love again in the course of 6 months, that's a drug. And I became so addicted to making those life changes with people that I got certified right away. And within a year of getting my training certificate, I started my first gym, which was called Lift in Beverly Hills, a very successful gym. Mm-hmm. And I also learned how to turn it into a medical clinic. So I was able, with my attorney, we created a contract. We were the first ones to do this. And then everybody started doing it. I was able to legally bill insurance for training sessions under a doctor's license and a chiropractor's license. So we were billing $800 per session.
That's brilliant.
Yeah. A little shady, but well. it got the job done, and it helped me raise enough money to own my dream gym, which was Sky Sport.
So you and Jillian opened Sky Sport, the gym that was featured on Workout in Beverly Hills. You guys opened that together in what year? Like, how long was the gym around before Bravo approached you?
Immediately. It's insane. First of all, this is how Jill approached the situation. We were not getting along. She worked for me as one of my trainers at Lyft. And she's so loud and damn obnoxious that it was really difficult in that small gym to work with her. So we were arguing a lot. Our relationship was pretty much over at that point. I told her, I'm going to own my own gym. I'm going to hire doctors to work for me. I'm going to be in medical management. And her answer to me was, if you don't make me your 50% partner, I will work against you. And I will take all your clients and I will open my own gym. Well, we broke up when she said that. But she's dangerous. So I made her my 50% partner. When she got Biggest Loser, though, she never spent even one day at the gym. She got Biggest Loser immediately. And I got Workout only 2 months into owning the gym. So basically, I had to pay her off just to go away. So I paid her off to go away within, say, 4 months of me opening the gym. I know this sounds like a trashing Jillian thing, but I've never told people any of this ever in my entire career. And these are true stories about 2 different ways to manage business. There's my way, and then there's her way. And they both get you to success, but her way leaves a lot of bodies in a river. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? Like, once she sued me and said she was going to come and start writing $50,000 checks off my business account in a gym that she never even spent one day at, I had to just pay her the money and get rid of her. And I think that's wrong. I think that's really horrible to do to somebody that you spent 6.5 years with.
Do you know Bob Harper at all?
Yes.
he never really comments on her anymore. I mean, you can kind of tell that he hates her.
He has a love-hate relationship. He hates her. So let me tell you, at the Abbey is a popular bar in West Hollywood.
Yeah.
And we'd all go on Sundays to the Abbey for years. Bob Harper was always there. He would get drunk and he would trash her like you would not believe. He's afraid of her. One, because she controlled Biggest Loser. She did a lot of things, including cheating, and she controlled it. And he told me all the scoop on what was going on that show. He never won. He was the Biggest Loser. Because he never won one contest. Jill won every single contest, every single series. So he hated her. He was envious of her, but a part of him also admired her shark-like instincts. And I think he was afraid of her. I really do.
Do you know, another thing about Jillian, are you aware, like Andy Cohen, he's often asked, like, who was the worst guest you ever had on Watch What Happens Live? And he's very vocal about the fact that it was Jillian. And the reason is because she screamed at his staff.
Yes, she's horrible. She's just a horrible person. I mean, if you don't get that from, you know, throwing wads of money at low-income people or calling somebody a fat fuck, you know, when you're in The Biggest Loser and you see an obese guy at the table and his butt's hanging out, and then you very loudly see that fat fuck there. I mean, she's a horrible person.
So going back, I want to get to how Bravo like came into the picture, and all of a sudden, so it sounds like you didn't have a game plan. It like really just fell into your lap. How is it that just one day somebody came to you with a pitch for a show?
Well, it wasn't even about me. Here's the crazy thing. I built such a beautiful gym that was so unique. Nobody's ever built this penthouse glass enclosed gym. We had a full running track around the entire top of the space. I mean, it was amazing. Okay, so I built this beautiful gym, and Amy Schpall was the executive producer of the show. She worked for Mentorn Productions, which is a British company. She came and she wanted to lease my space to do a TV show in. And she sat across from me in my office, and the more she talked to me, I could see it looking over her face. And by the end of that session, she goes, I want to come and videotape you tomorrow and just follow you all day. Can I do that? She goes, I don't want to do a show about other people. I want to do a show about you. And she did. She took a handy cam. I did my own makeup. In fact, the whole first season, I did my everything. Did my own makeup, all that. And I was with Mimi. She was my girlfriend.
Yeah.
And she just follows around with like a little hand camera. She submitted it to her Bravo. And the head executive, Lauren Zelaznik, who mm-hmm. everybody knows,
yeah.
Called me and said, we don't have enough money in our budget to order it this season, but don't sell your show. Just wait for us. And so the next season, we got the show, and the rest was history. It fell into my lap.
Wow.
They were only looking to shoot there.
And so so that's how the show got made. And then, I mean, we were talking about earlier, like there really were not many reality stars who were out in the early 2000s. Like maybe a couple of people on The Real World, like you mentioned Ellen.
Yeah.
And you, like you really were, you know, for somebody like me who, you know, came out in the year 2000 or 2001, you really were one of those like major figures, you know,
right.
Like who else were we to turn to for like examples of people who we could like sort of relate to?
Or just successful women that were gay and proud about it. I've always been proud. I've always been out. Since I was 21, actually. When I got my first substantial relationship and truly fell in love, that's usually when people want to come out because they want to share that love with their family and their friends. But there weren't any examples. The L word was not out when my show first came out. It came out later. I remember it because I watched it. So we really did not, outside of Ellen and maybe, who's that singer?
Melissa Etheridge?
Yes. See, you even know.
Yeah. And like Rosie at that time was out. But yeah, you were like a cooler version. Like, you know, Melissa Etheridge, Rosie, Ellen, these are not like, you know, you were like the next generation.
Yeah, exactly. But you know, if, for instance, if that show was done today, it would be much more successful, and I would have been much more successful doing it, because now it is not a stigma for most cultures to have, you know, out, gay, proud, beautiful, not beautiful people, whatever. It's right. Just, it's more of our culture, and we're much more accepting of it, and we're much more loving. At that time, there just simply were not examples, except for poor Ellen DeGeneres, who got her ass served to her when she came out. And I saw that, and I remember talking with Mimi and saying, how far should we go? Should we ever kiss on TV? We rarely kissed on TV when we were truly very affectionate in real life. And because we didn't want to throw it in people's faces, because we were worried about the backlash.
Was Andy Cohen a producer on your show? Like, how involved was he at all?
He initially was, but then Andy was really into the Housewives. Mm-hmm. So Andy's baby was mostly the Housewives. But yes, Andy was the producer on our show. And then Andy wanted to be a star, and he got his show. And so he pretty much stepped down from all executive producing roles.
Mm-hmm. Were the Housewives on at all at the time Workout first premiered?
No. Project Runway was their baby. Do you remember when Bravo used to do uplifting, wonderful shows? And now Bravo is just an ugly cesspool of women behaving like children and behaving badly. I don't even watch that junk anymore. But remember when it was Queer Eye?
Yeah.
For the Straight Guy, which is a very loving and inspirational show that people loved. Do you remember when it was Project Runway, where these kids were finding their dream and making their lives happen? Do you remember that programming they used to be known for? That was when they were number one in the game. Then they brought on the Housewives, and also Blowout.
Blowout was amazing.
Right. And then Workout was a little uglier than Blowout, but that's when it started going downhill, where they just started really wanting to ratchet.
Did any of the Beverly Hills, or the women who would later get cast on Real Housewives of Beverly Hills, did you know them at all from your gym?
All of them.
Like who?
All of them. I knew all the New York gals. I knew all the Beverly Hills gals. I knew, I'd say, half the Orange County girls. And that's because we all used to have to do press together. So we would see each other backstage. And also, Bravo requires you to do a lot of parties. You got to go to a lot of parties and work red carpets. And they get you the limo, and they get your hair and makeup, and you look beautiful, and you got your outfit. So it was fun. I enjoyed all that.
Who did you connect with or have a fun time with from any of those shows? Like, was there anybody in particular who you like had a...
Yeah. I really liked Patty Stanger.
Oh my God.
I really felt that, yeah, Patty and I, we were in first class flight, and we really enjoyed talking to each other. She's a very good, genuine person. It didn't always come off on her show, because she has to be clipped, and she knows how smart to be to not drag a story out or whatever, just to be very clipped. But she's great. And then also, I was friends with and saw everywhere another gay icon. Who was the girl that used to do the hair salon?
Tabitha.
So Tabitha and I ran in the same circles. And she is a tough audience. I mean, she does not like doing press. And she does not like doing red carpets, okay? She makes that very clear. And I just remember I was drunk one time at the Abbey, and she was like staring me down and just giving me so much judgment. And I was like, okay, I'm stop judging. I can see you judging right now.
Wait, can we talk about the fact that you keep referencing the Abbey, which is like, I mean, anybody, you know, who's visited LA, like the Abbey is right there in West Hollywood on the corner of Santa Monica. Isn't it interesting how Lisa Vanderpump is like slowly, or not even so slowly, taking over that entire area?
Yeah, she has, but it's also gone way down. The Abbey used to have super professional, just super good looking crowd. I mean, you would meet your next girlfriend or boyfriend at the Abbey. I mean, it was as simple as that. Mm-hmm. People at the top of their industry, people that ran Fortune 500 companies loved it. A lot of celebrities. I've hung out with so many celebrities, big A-list celebrities at the Abbey. Now, I haven't been to the Abbey in 8 years because it's such a trash hole now. Nobody goes.
I mean, it's just interesting how Lisa Vanderpump just like Pump, Sir, they're all Tom, they're all like right on that literal corner.
You know why? Most of the time she had two TV shows promoting all of her business.
Yeah.
So basically, it's huge. It's just huge.
Yeah. So tell me about your actual experience doing workout. Give me like the good, the bad, the ugly. Like, how did it impact your life?
I was miserable from beginning to end. I was asked to do a lot of things that were completely against my moral fabric, that were completely out of my comfort zone because I'm a very self-protective person. I was bullied and pressured and told if I didn't have a girlfriend this season, if I didn't have like, you know, something going on, that I was, that they were going to cancel me. There were always bullying saying, if you don't give this, if you don't cry in the therapist's office, we're going to cancel you. It was horrible. It was the worst experience of my life.
Well, it hinged on drama in your personal life.
That's right. And guess what? I don't have a dramatic life. I don't. So guess what we did? We made up 90% of that drama. Do you think I would ever, the cast, they weren't even trainers, they were actors. The only trainer that made the actual show was Erica. She worked for me at Sky Sport. She's the only one. The rest were just actors.
Really?
Yes. None of them were trainers, especially Brian Peeler. He was a total moron. All he did is take steroids. He couldn't even lift like as much as a child. So bottom line is I hated the trainers. I thought they were disgusting because I was a real trainer. And I knew these trainers didn't know anything about anything. But I did appreciate that they brought drama because I knew that's what people needed and wanted. Or at least that's what I was told on a daily basis. Can you imagine going into a therapist's office and being told exactly how to perform and that you're not good enough and that you're being boring and that you're awful? And then you still have 10 more hours of shooting that day when you've been trashed and said that you're not interesting enough?
So it was the producers who were...
Yes, yes. The producers who were fully supported by Andy Cohen and everybody else.
So you were burned pretty badly. I mean, what was the best thing that came out of it?
My book deals, which were 2 New York Times bestsellers. And then the last one I did just now. And so it gave me opportunities that I couldn't have gotten just by being a gym owner.
I mean, it's amazing that show lasted 3 entire seasons. Cause like,
well, the last season was a straight guy who I hate his guts. And he came in as a producer. They forced him upon me. They fired the second producer that did second season, which was my favorite season. He hated me. He hated women. He was a misogynist. He hated lesbians. I grossed him out. He didn't like short-haired women. He just didn't like lesbians, okay? He was a misogynist kind of, you know, dude. And he didn't get me. He didn't understand me. He didn't like me. And he would cut and paste. So, for instance, I would say something off camera, and then he would turn that into a storyline and surprise me with it, with someone else saying it to me. I did the best work of my life that third season. I transformed like 10 people's lives, tears, crying, but happy tears. They didn't show any of it. What he submitted to Andy Cohen was every nasty little thing that he spliced together in the editing. And I will never forgive Bravo for not talking to me and saying, hey, what's going on? Why is it this season you seem to be saying things or doing things that are out of character? In fact, I screamed at Andy Cohen at the top of my lungs. You spent 2 years building up my brand, a positive brand. And in one season, you let this asshole tear me down.
Mm-hmm.
So when people say that it's not edited, they can edit you any way they want. They're so savvy. They'll take a conversation from Saturday and they'll splice it with a conversation from Tuesday to make you look like you're saying something that you have never said. I mean it. It's that bad.
Is that the reason why? Because you did a second show with Bravo called Fintervention. Is that why you kind of refused to showcase any of your personal life?
Yes, Yes, because I'd been so burned. And I realized I killed that show. That show would have been really successful if I had done sit-down interviews, told people what my personal perspective with the rest of the cast was like. I was so burned by that third season. Like, it nearly destroyed my career, what they did to me on that third season. I was so burned by that that I would not show an ounce of emotion. All I did is come on camera and I gave people tips, I trained them, and I helped them with eating. I got no emotions whatsoever. Mm-hmm. And that's not what people wanted from me. So I can understand. I mean, it got me celebrity clients a lot. Julia Roberts was a fan of the show. Alanis Morissette, too. I've trained so many celebrities. But I didn't have any kind of emotion because I was so afraid that they were going to edit me to look terrible.
Would you work in TV again? Like if somebody came?
Never. I don't care. I have been asked and I have flat out said no. I will never work in television again. I find reality TV to be a complete lie, a falsification of true events. Here's what they do. They say there's not enough drama. So we're going to take all the trainers. We're going to get them super wasted. We're going to close them in a room in Palm Springs. We're going to tell them what they need to talk about, or they're not good enough, or they're not going to be in the scene. So then all these trainers are scared because they're not going to get camera time unless they throw a glass of water across into someone's face. That happened. We're taking you off camera, Jesse, unless you do something drastic. That's sick.
So moving away from the show, can we talk about how the fitness industry has completely changed? Most pronounced now because of the pandemic. Like, everything is online.
Right. Well, so check this out. I charge $400 an hour in Los Angeles. And of course, it's my very wealthy clients. It's my celebrity clients that I've been with for years. Okay. And they pay me $400 an hour, but we do a lot. I mean, I control all of their dietary stuff. I control everything with health and wellness in their life. And I come to their house. And some of them, you know, I lived in Laurel Canyon, not in the outskirts of Malibu. So, you know, you're talking like an hour drive there, hour drive back, and an hour session. And all the celebrities live in Malibu. So anyway, and I charge $200 for a half an hour session. So the pandemic hit. The gyms closed. I was devastated because I just moved to Ohio. And was fully getting a PR person here that was so excited to say, our girl, Jackie Warner, she's back after 33 years. She's retiring here, but she's not retiring. She's training. We were going to do this whole fun thing, and then everything stopped. So I said, what can I do? Because I felt bad not being able to work out. I was like, what can I do to help people during this crisis? I lowered my rate down to $50 a session. So from $200 for a half an hour session, I moved to $50 for a half an hour session. I moved everything to FaceTime and to Google, like an Android or an iPhone. And I found I had such a talent for training people online, and that people in 2 weeks were getting drastic weight loss and drastic changes in their life, that I became obsessed. And I've not ever even put an article out about it. You're the first person that I'm even talking to, just on social media I've done. And I've got a full schedule. And now what I'm doing is I'm looking for 5 fantastic trainers that have at least 5 years of training experience. And I'm going to train them how to be amazing video trainers, like really, really amazing. Because it takes a talent, because I stay still. I talk you through everything. You have to be so succinct. You have to be so on point. You have to, because it goes quick, a 30-minute session, and I get everything I need to get in. So typically, I'll work with someone. They pay me $150 a week. They get 3 sessions at $50. I'm happy. They're happy. I live in Ohio now. The cost of living isn't, you know, millions of dollars here.
So how do people, like, if people want to actually work with you,
yeah,
how do they connect with you?
my business line. I'll give it to you right now.
Sure.
It's a 323-301-3522. So 323-301-3522. Text, I get back to you right away. It's me. And I have a very personal relationship like I've never had in my past experiences. This is what I needed at this time in my life. I needed to have a much more personal relationship with my clients, you know?
What inspired you to leave? Like, you sold your house in LA? Like, you are fully...
Yes, I sold my house in LA.
What inspired you to leave?
Right, because honestly, I felt I could not do one stupid nightclub or girls' drunken brunch or one more shopping trip at the Beverly Center or at Bloomingdale's or Barney's. I've lived there 33 years. I was over it. Like, how many times can you have a superficial life? How long? And my family is here. Mm-hmm. I've got four nieces and nephews here.
Cute.
I've got my only brother, my only sibling is here. And we never knew each other as children because he's 11 years younger than me. And I've got my parents. My mom's getting old. She just turned 70 2 days ago. And I want to be here for them. I want to experience going over to their house
beautiful.
Every single day.
It's beautiful.
You know? And now that I'm doing the video training, oh, I'll probably do gym training too. I'll probably get to the gym at night because now I'm bored. I get all my video training done by 1 o'clock.
Uh-huh.
And then I'm like, okay, I'm in Beaver Creek, Ohio. Now what? You know?
Yeah.
So I'll probably start hitting the gym so I can socialize. And I love being around trainers, you know? All my best friends are always trainers. So yeah. So trainers that are interested in working for me at $50 an hour is what they get paid. I teach them, I certify them. They can get working right away as part of my team. They call that business line too.
What's the most common theme you see in people who are overweight or like have that addiction?
Oh my gosh. The most common theme is because they don't have anything in their life that is satisfying. So let's say you go to a job. I don't know many people that enjoy their jobs, okay? Especially people that are low income to middle class. Most people take a job that they feel they can do and they make their money. They can barely pay their expenses. How many news articles do we see? 70% of Americans live paycheck to paycheck. That's horrifying. They don't have anything else that gives them pleasure. So what is a legal way to get quick pleasure? Well, it's Arby's, it's McDonald's, it's macaroni and cheese out of a box, it's donuts, it's a bag of candy, it's all of these things. They're legal and they're everywhere. So you can have access to them and you're not a drunk in the street. You're not using heroin in the street. It's a secret addiction too. You go home and you eat 10,000 calories per meal because you've starved yourself all day and now you're starving and you want all your comfort foods. The thread that I see between all obese, and by the way, you're obese if you're 60 pounds and over. That's not a lot. Okay, so the common thread of commonality is that they skip meals and only one meal a day. Because what happens is their blood sugar drops so drastically, the next thing they put in their body is twice as effectively stored as fat.
Got it. What are your thoughts on intermittent fasting?
And I do intermittent. I eat my first meal after my workout at about 11 or 12 o'clock mm-hmm. and my last meal at night at about 6:37. And I'm fine with that. I like that. And it did help me. I gained weight. I gained like 50 pounds in California, but I lost it in 2 months because I put myself on a diet.
Were you able to really tap into why you gained weight?
Oh my gosh, 100%. It's because I was living a shallow, ridiculous lifestyle in LA and I didn't have my family. I only had sort of a handful of superficial friends. Well, I'm not a superficial person. I'm a very sensitive person. And so it was hardening me. It was making me isolate. I started isolating more because I wasn't happy with my life in LA anymore. And it's so funny. Not once. My whole family was like, oh my gosh, Jackie's going to wake up one day in Beaver Creek and she's going to miss LA. And she's going to be like, oh my gosh, I can't go to Barney's. Because there is no Barney's in Ohio.
Also, Barney's has completely closed. They're out of business.
That's true. Or Bloomingdale's is like 2 hours away, okay? So, you know, she's not going to be able to go to Whole Foods every day. I have not missed one person. I hate to say it if someone's listening to this in my life. I've not missed one friendship, one thing, one green juice, one Whole Foods experience at all in the 4 months that I've been here.
So you moved there right when the virus started.
I moved here February 29th, and 1 week later, coronavirus hit.
That is crazy.
Well, we know that, I mean, God told me to do that. I believe in God, and God fully told me to get the hell out of LA because I was able to live with my parents in their big house for 3 months while everybody else was having to isolate. What if I'd had to isolate my own home? That would have been terrible.
Right. Something I wanted to talk to you about, you recently, maybe it was a few months ago, you had posted some photos and people maybe in the comments were commenting on your appearance and you came back at them. Can you like talk a little bit more about that?
Well, I gained weight and so my face got fat. So everybody was saying I've ruined my face with fillers, but I don't get fillers. I don't get fillers. I've been here for 4 months. My face still is fat through here. And I'm aging like my mom. We get pudgy cheeks here. And so I resent that because I'm not trying to change my appearance at all, except through working out and health. And I still have 10 pounds to lose and 7 pounds of muscle to put on. My face, you looking at me, is going to look totally different 2 months from now. It'll hollow out like I always do, but I've always had naturally very high cheekbones. I've always had eyes that go up, you know, Asian eyes. These are characteristics I've always had. But when I gained and got up to 172 pounds, like right now I'm at 138, but when I gained 172 pounds, I did look different. And it did look like I just went crazy with fillers. And so I did have to correct people. And so I just say, you know, oh, thanks for, you know, I'll come back snarky. And then I just say, don't follow me anymore. And if they do it again and focus on my looks, I just block them.
Tell me what you, I guess we'll wrap up. Tell me what you love most about working with clients and coaching and training them.
I love that they have so much trust in me that they give me rein in every part of their life, their love life, their work life, their food life. Their lives with their children, their lives with their parents. They let me in and want my guidance because I've done this for 25 years and all of my clients have read my books. They know that I know what I'm talking about.
Tell us the names of the books so people can check them out.
This is Why You're Fat and How to Get Thin Forever. 10 pounds in 10 days, my secret celebrity diet. It's what I put all my celebrities on when they have to do like a photo shoot or work the red carpet or go to the Oscars. And then my last one was This Is Why You're Sick and Tired. And that was my best book. It was my least selling book. But I'm telling you, pick up that book because I have the best content in there and the best diets in there that I've ever written.
This Is Why You're Sick and Tired.
Yeah, and it just keeps you away from the doctor for the rest of your life. You don't ever have to be sick. You don't have to have an autoimmune disorder like chronic fatigue syndrome or fibromyalgia or skin disorders or breakouts. That's something that's being done by your lifestyle.
Can you give like two or three ways that people can increase or boost their self-esteem?
Yeah, find something that's creative and do that. And admire that. Find something that you can create. Maybe it's a journal. And maybe you write a journal entry a day and you look back at that and just say, wow, I really nailed it. Like I wrote that well. Maybe it's writing poetry. I write poetry all the time. And I admire my own work. And I'm not ashamed to say that. You should. You know, I've gotten to a point that I absolutely love the way my mind works. I'm never lonely, and I love being by myself because of my intricate mind. And I'm always reading. I'm always learning, constantly learning, and I will to the day I die. I find everything intriguing. So finding something creative and doing that on an ongoing, you know, semi-regular basis really helps you admire yourself. And here's the biggest thing that's going to help you with self-esteem. Now, do you remember when we were kids and, you know, some kids, like, let's say you didn't study and the teacher said, study for your quiz on Friday, study for your test, study for your test, but you procrastinated and you didn't do it. So you show up for your test, you're 7, 8 years old, you fail the test, it goes on your report card, you get a note sent home. That builds poor self-esteem because you failed and you didn't put the effort into it. What builds great self-esteem is if you did do the studying, you get an A, and everybody around you says, great job, Jackie. Good job. You got an A. Your teacher does. The other kids admire you. Your mom is proud of you. She gives you a star up on the board. We are children. We are still children. We're adults in every age, even at 70. Our minds still activate and are activated by childish things. And the same way as an adult, if you give yourself a goal in life that is just too difficult, like I'm going to lose 60 pounds in 3 months, every day that you fail at that goal, you hate yourself and it's negative self-esteem. But if you give yourself a goal saying, I'm going to drink 2 liters of water a day and do it for 3 months. That's a doable goal. That is an achievable goal. And at the end of that 3 months, not only have you sped up your metabolism with the water because it's a liver cleanser by 33%, but you've achieved the goal and you're proud of yourself. Well, I've done enough things in my life that I'm proud of. I like myself and I like my conversational skills. I like the way my mind works. But that hasn't always been the case. Everybody has ups and downs. And when I gained all that weight, I didn't like myself because I failed on a weekly basis. And that caused poor self-esteem.
You have said, the reason why I asked about the self-esteem is because you have said that it is really low self-esteem that is like the seed of the addiction.
It is, because it's that self-hatred. You know, I used to say when I was younger, the greatest feeling in the world is waking up semi-nude in your bed and just running your hands over your totally fit body. Mm-hmm. Just being strong as a woman. Being strong as a woman is much more powerful than being strong as a man. It's expected of men. And they'll always have more strength, even if they don't work out, than women. But being powerful and strong physically as a woman is such a self-esteem booster.
I love it. Jackie, tell everyone, give everyone the number one more time, and also where everybody can follow you on social media.
Oh, honey, I don't even bother. I can't stand social media. I basically go on social media once every 3 to 4 months. So it's better just to text me.
Okay. So give the number again.
Here's my business number. It's 323-301-3522. And I get back to every single person personally that texts me and go through, you know, what we need to go through.
Awesome.
And trainers, also awesome trainers, please also call that number or text so I can add you to my staff so I can get you going.
Fantastic. Jackie, this has been so much fun to like catch up with you. And it's sort of amazing that you moved back to your hometown, or, you know, like your home state, and you're going to, you know, retire/not retire there and see what happens. It's amazing.
It's crazy because everything I've told you today, I've never told anybody else. You know all my secrets now.
I mean, the stuff about Jillian Michaels, really, that's a headline. That's some good shit.
It was a great conversation. You were a pleasure to talk to, and thank you so much.
Thank you, Jackie. Guys, you can follow me, JessXNYC, follow the show account, Hot Takes Deep Dives, and we'll see you soon.